as a result, they all started escaping by boat. Most of them came via the West Indies. Many brought slaves with them, and they bought this big chunk of land that was largely uninhabited. The Siwanoy Indians encamped all along the shoreline, but this big chunk of very fertile land became farmland for the Huguenots. And they took this long, slender piece of land and they drew a line down it. And then on each side, they made divisions and each person got a chunk of land that would become their farm. That line today is North Avenue. And we're traveling right down on North Avenue. We're going to turn onto Pelham Road, which in very early times was the American Indian's pathway along the banks of Long Island Sound. And it later became that what it is today, Pelham Road. Still lined with beach clubs that are taking advantage of the waterfront as well. When the Huguenots were living here in the early, late 1600s, early 1700s, they were all farmers. And there were, you just have to use your imagination that this was just all farmland. They cut down trees, they built roads, they built houses out of stone, and they took advantage of their access to the water by growing crops that were made into products by these mills, these huge paddle wheels that were powered by the tides, would transform the crops into products that would be shipped out to places as far away as India. And that's how they made their money. By the early 1800s, the steamboat had been invented. And as a result, New Rochelle became one of the leading resorts. You know how Miami is today? New Rochelle was a destination like Miami is. All along this road were grand hotels and resorts, and tens of thousands of people would get off the trolley and come to New Rochelle to stay in the hotels. And these parks started developing, including Hudson Park over here, was a picnic road. The trolley would go right down and people would get off and get on a steamboat or spend the day at Hudson Park. Today, it's a municipal park. It was bought by the village of New Rochelle in 1883 for a big sum of $38,000. And today, we still have a beautiful band shell and a gorgeous view of Echo Bay, which is very rich in history. The marina you see here is the municipal marina. It was New Rochelle Coal and Lumber, but during the Revolutionary War time, there was a tavern here, and all the people in the area would gather to talk about the war, and there were whaleboatmen, because there were whales in Long Island Sound, and these whaleboatmen would hide in a creek over here. This neighborhood here is Sutton Manor, one of the many residential parks throughout New Rochelle. By the late 1800s, New Rochelle was so popular. People had come here for vacations, liked the place so much that they wanted to live here. And they knew they could get on the train and get to Manhattan like that, make their money, then come home and live in a quiet, beautiful area right by the water. And these neighborhoods called residential parks started developing all around. The one we just passed was Sutton Manor. That was developed by a group of yachtsmen. And today, the neighbors in that community still have a boathouse. Coming up on the right was the former home of New Rochelle's movie company. In 1913, New Rochelle was known across the world because there was a movie company in this building and this building, and they made silent films. It was called Thanhouser Silent Movie Company. And the films went coast to coast. Coming up on your left, you're going to see the World War I monument. This was a memorial that was created by the New Rochelle Art Association members, dedicated to the men who lost their lives in World War I. It sits on a piece of land called Faneuil Park, named for Peter Faneuil, who was born in New Rochelle in 1700. We're going to take a left in the light. The armory, which we just passed, was constructed in the early 1930s for New Rochelle's naval militia. We're going to go left right here. Now, if you look up a little further, you can see maybe a tower. Well, when we turn, you might see the mansion that's part of Salesian School. That was called Clifford, and it was built by John Stevenson, who was the inventor of the streetcar, which was the predecessor to trolleys. He invented it. If you go to the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C., you'll see a great exhibit about this man, John Stevenson, who had his home, Clifford, right over there, that big mansion. He owned all this property, and after he died, his widow sold it off to become the Stevenson neighborhood. A lot of you are too young, but there used to be an elementary school right up here called Stevenson Elementary. It was closed in the early 1980s and torn down. And even earlier times, this was all a big lake called Crystal Lake.
Barbara, Stevenson designed the first streetcar, right?
Right.
And this is, did he live on this street?
No, he lived in the Clifford, but he owned all this property. But he was known as the inventor of the streetcar, which then developed into the trolley on tracks that motorized. This is where Stevenson Elementary School was located.
Named after him?
The whole neighborhood was named after John Stevenson, but this was called Home Park. Another one of the residential parks developed in the early 1900s, and this was developed for the working class. The houses are closer together. They're even the first row houses in New Rochelle, so that there was sort of affordable housing was built into the design.
How many such?
And we're going to go right here. By 1930, there were about 30 residential parks in New Rochelle, and they started with Rochelle Park, which we're going to be driving by, and then many more were developed because it was so popular. Today, it's the strength of New Rochelle, the neighborhoods that are still, even despite the many years of progress, the basic characteristics that they started with still are maintained. There's open space, many islands, there's setbacks in many of them, so people have a good view shed. When we get up here, we're going to cross over the bridge, and you get a good view of I-95. First, the train sliced its way through New Rochelle in 1848, and then in the 1950s, I-95 sliced right through the heart of New Rochelle, and you see, you get a good view of both these transportation modes. I bet you didn't know that the toll booth on I-95 at exit 16 is the busiest toll booth in the country. I-95 is a major route between Maine and Florida, and this toll booth sees more cars than any other toll booth. This is Rochelle Park, which was one of the earliest planned neighborhoods in the country, and as a result, it's a historic district today. The homes were designed in architecture typical of the Victorian period, and they're still maintained today. If you want to change or alter your house, and you live in Rochelle Park or Rochelle Heights, you have to go before a board to get permission. It's the neighbors who wanted this designation because they realized that the more integrity they kept in their neighborhood, the more value there was. And sure enough, when they became designated, the property values just kept rising and rising. And today, it's a very tight-knit group, and they just went for national register listing and won that as well.
Wasn't that also the prominent area for black doctors and lawyers?
One of the first neighborhoods in New Rochelle for the upper black middle class. The black upper middle class. And then notice the two, up here, notice the two pillars on the side, the stone pillars, and then at the bottom of the hill we're going right, and then a left on the other side of the pond. These pillars mark the entrance to Beachmont. All around New Rochelle, you see these kind of pillars, and that's, you know, you're entering a residential park, a planned neighborhood. Beachmont was developed in 1902 by a group of wealthy New Rochelle people. It's usually a lawyer, a banker, and then left it at the other.
Right.
They dammed up what's part of Pine Brook and made this lake. This is the centerpiece of the neighborhood. This is now Beachmont Lake. And this waterway, if you were to throw dye in here, it would end up, you'd see that same dye in Long Island Sound. It's all part of one water system that makes its way through New Rochelle. So we're now on Pine Brook Boulevard that was developed on both sides of this brook. And we'll travel along here and then we'll go up Quaker Ridge Road.